Where do our loyalties lie?
So why Ahmadiyyat?
They're not fanatics, they're sick.
To make a better world for everyone.
With real stories.
You know, there's nothing that I've done differently, I've just been me.
Real issues.
Is it possible to be loyal to two different countries?
Real views. This is Real Talk Canada. In today's world, we live in a global economy in every sense of the term. With some of the most industrialized nations like Greece, Spain, Italy, going some of the most difficult economical crises whose ripple effects are being felt all over Europe, here in North America, most recently, the world had a chance to see in the U.S. presidential election between Barack Obama and Mitt Romney, one of the hottest topics was job creation. On today's episode, we're discussing career choices, what moves to consider, what to think about, what choices to make with real stories, real issues, real views. This is Real Talk Canada. With me today is an expert panel along with a live studio audience. To my immediate right, we have Mautar Saab, who is the director of AMSA Canada, Ahmadiyya Muslim Students Association, who's also an economist, currently a law student, and also taught at York University. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
To his immediate right, we have Dr. Najam Mia Sahib, who's a resident physician at the University of Toronto, completed his medical school in Edmonton at the University of Alberta, specializing in physical medicine and rehabilitation. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
And to his immediate right, we have Mutib Ahmed, who runs his own HR and recruiting consulting practice, over 10 years of experience in recruiting and staffing. He has started two startup companies. He has clients all across North America, including various Fortune 100 companies. He's got a business degree from Ryerson University. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
And now we're going to take a quick break to watch Word on the Street about career choices.
I think we definitely help in making career choices for students that come into the school, because they come in and they have ideas of, oh, you know, I want to be a, you know, an engineer, or I want to be a, you know, a doctor. And these ideas are great early on, but as they get older, they start to realize that their ideas of what they want to be or their career choice changes. I think it's good to not decide until they're ready. And what I mean is, you know, there's going to be so many ideas that will come into your head, but when you start to think more about, you know, oh, I think I really like, you know, photography, for example, then that's something that the more you think about, the more you're going to settle on. And that's what I mean by, you know, don't decide until you're ready. When you've settled on something, or you have an idea of, oh, you know, I want to, you know, either become a photographer or an engineer or something like that, the best thing to do, and I give this advice a lot to a lot of students, is take the time to volunteer. You won't get a job right away. So in order to find out really what that job is about, take some time, volunteer your time, and spend the time with those professionals. When you do that, you start to realize that really what the job is about, and is this something that you really want to do? Do you really enjoy it as much as you thought you might enjoy it? The other thing that comes from that is, as you're doing your volunteer time, asking those questions. Asking the questions, and what I mean by that is, talk to those professionals that you're volunteering with. How long have they been doing their job for? Do they like it? Is there a balance between work and life? What are the advantages from it? What are the disadvantages? All these questions and answers that you can get from it will really give you a much better idea as to whether this is a job that or a career that you will really enjoy, or whether this is something, you know, that you might want to keep as a backup for something else. The last thing is, you know, as you're doing your volunteer time, it's great to keep a network of people and contacts that you want to keep in touch with, even if you decide not to keep that career, because those people can end up being mentors to you and can help you, you know, point you in the right direction, even if it's, like I said, not the same career that you're choosing to do. So keeping networks, talking to people, volunteering your time, all these things are really important when it comes to, you know, narrowing down your search or for what you're trying to decide on what your career might be. The other things that are involved is to think about your strengths and weaknesses. I mean, a lot of students that are young would love to become a NBA basketball player or a baseball player or a hockey player, just because they love sports and they love watching sports and they love playing them. Not everyone can become an athlete. So it's important to think about, what am I good at? Am I really, really good at drawing? Am I really, really good at math? Am I really, really good at athletics? When you've decided when you realize what your strengths are, use those strengths and think about, what can I do with the strengths that I have, and what careers can I make of what I'm really good at? I think it's important to listen to the advice that is being given to you, but ultimately you have to make your own decision. Listen to what your parents are saying to you, listen to what professionals are saying to you, listen to your teachers, your friends, adults that are older than you and who are already working and have established careers. Those are the people the most who know mostly what they're talking about and can give you proper advice. In the end, you really have to do your research on what career choices you are willing to make and what really works for you and what you can see yourself doing for a long period of time.
And welcome back. So straight away, I want to go into my panel in the front, and I really want to talk about those initial steps. Careers drive economies, funded by whether it's financial means or choices that people make, and how many professionals a group or an entity or a country has. Mozab, if I can start with you, what are some of the stepping stones when you're making those career choices?
First of all, the education starts from the cradle to the grave. So when you're talking about a career, it is important to be educated towards that career. One starts to recognize in early one's life, whether it's your parents who tell you that, you know, you were so good in this, you could draw so well, you were good in music. So career choices that come in later in life, on average, it is said that a university student thinks about three different careers to change in life. So early days, it's crucial. And then when you are in high school, you're exposed more to the world. And then when you're in the freshman, sophomore years, then you get more general ed courses, you're geared towards, you understand your aptitude. So in those years, you get to know which career you're geared towards.
So Najam, I want to come to you. Mm-hmm. How does formal education, and how big of a role does it really play today? Whether it's post-grad, during grad, once you're in the field, you know, it's such a long journey, especially when one thinks about being a doctor. How do you A, make that decision and stick to it?
Yeah, so I think it's very important to be focused and to figure out what you want to do at the end of the day, regardless of whatever education you need to encompass along the way. So you probably start thinking of these things around high school, and, you know, looking towards medicine, it's a daunting task at times. You're looking at, you know, 4 years of undergrad school, 4 years of med school, followed by postgraduate studies. So it's very important to, you know, have a focus as to, this is what I want to be, and regardless of what I need to do, and incorporate whatever formal education you need to along the way.
Gentlemen, a term that gets thrown around more and more than careers today is career development. It's not just a career that you want, there's a development process behind it. And Mateeb, you're a recruiter, a so-called headhunter for some of the bigger firms out there. What does that really mean, career development? Is that something you start while you're getting your formal education? Is that something when you have the job and you develop and you practice that trade? If you can shed some light on career development.
So, you know, I think career development is very similar to education today, where it's lifelong. It is something where you are constantly working at. It's a continuous work in progress. You know, statistics say these days that the average person will change careers maybe 3 to 4 times in their lifetime. So
that keeps you busy as a recruiter, right?
That keeps me busy, yes. You know, I think that it sort of stays in lines with education, that as education is continuous and lifelong, so is career development. And I think regardless of whatever profession you're in these days, it's very important to stay on top of it. So whether you are an architect or a doctor or a lawyer, continuous education is just part of, I think, what keeps you your skills sharp and what keeps you, I think, at the peak of what you're doing. So it's a very important piece.
Yeah. I want to come to the audience because there's a general understanding of the perfect career. It's either you're a lawyer or a doctor. Parents often say, I want my son to be a doctor or a lawyer. You don't ever hear, I want my son to grow up to be a graphic designer, or though it's a great career, or I want them to be in one of those unorthodox fields. So I want to come to the audience here. Did you have that pressure, expectation of what you were forecasted to be and what you've decided to do, if you can start?
Sure. Early on, I was fortunate enough to already have like a good knowledge of science, and that was my forte, I guess. So it came naturally to me. So
you didn't feel any pressure of a field one way or the other?
Well, I had my older brother who was already in science, so I was going in his footsteps. So it seemed like a good fit for me. That was expected of me from my parents, and it was something that I was interested in. So it worked out.
It was a perfect match. It's what you wanted.
Yeah, so I was lucky in that regard. So, okay. But for other people, if it doesn't work out, then they definitely need to stand up for themselves and. Because this is a decision that they will have to live with forever, so this would be a good time to stand up and then choose what they really want to do.
Sure, if we can get the mic up here. Did you feel any, right up here, did you feel any expectation, parents, society, friends?
Yeah, I feel the expectation has to, it generally comes about with the demand in society, so you might be good at a certain skill set, but the society might not need it. So sometimes
or
you have to.
The current economy doesn't have any fitting.
Yeah, for example, artists are not considered very needed in society. Nobody really thinks much about art. It's more about industry, you know, making engineers, doctors, things that you need all the time. But sometimes when you see have an eye for it, then you'll realize that it is necessary. It could revolutionize society, but in the mainstream, it's not recognized. But sometimes you have to put that aside and take it as a hobby, or you know, do that later on in your life once you're settled, because you need to make money, and that is where you're gonna go to see where society needs you. It's not about what you need, because you have to fit in somewhere, right?
Sure. And most of, as an economist, there's hobby versus what the economy justifies as the ideal job. How do you pave the path? We still see great examples of somebody really pursued what they wanted, made it happen, versus somebody looking at the economy and going, "Wow, there's clearly a need of a profession more than other." How do you find that fine line between the two?
There are those traditional jobs that are very famous. You know, we keep mentioning doctors, lawyers, engineers, but more so, other field of study are important as well. Artists have jobs in today's economy, but if we are talking about a turmoil, you know, if we're talking about an unrest, you know, everybody's in unrest in an economy. So overall, if you have gone through a good education system, a formal education system, you have more backing behind you. There's one thing that is famous, which is that every additional year that you put after your high school, in long run, in your working life, it gives you great returns. So even an additional year in a master's program will give you more returns over your working life than your first 4 years of bachelor's or honors specialized degree.
Okay. And Motsub, I want to come to you based on what Motsub just said, that, you know, of course, having that formal education helps you earn those stripes. And really, in today's economy, as you're looking ahead, as you sift through a lot of these resumes, really, how relevant is that?
Formal education?
Sure.
I think it's very important. I think that there is a place where it definitely in certain careers, in certain industries, it might not be as important. So for instance, let's say, for example, in technology, the importance of a degree is very much there. But I know lots of people who are in very senior levels in technology because they had an aptitude for it, they were technically inclined, but didn't necessarily have the formal education. So it really depends on the profession. Obviously, if it's something like law or medicine, that's something you could not pursue without formal education and having a higher learning and obviously pursuing postgraduate degrees. So it really depends on the profession. But the formal education is not the only component that, as from a recruiting perspective, I would look at when assessing someone.
And there's certain skill sets out there that people say that you're just gifted with that. You're,
right.
You know, you're a gifted artist, or you're a, you know, you're You're gifted with a gift of gab for some of the people, and I want to talk about that. How much of a factor does that really play?
I think that's a pretty big factor. It's sort of a natural inclination towards, I think one of the gentlemen mentioned, math or science. So there could be natural inclination towards writing, towards medicine, towards law. So absolutely, if there are certain talents and gifts, I think sometimes we attribute talents and gifts to the arts or sports only. But, and that's what sometimes society only views as a talent. But really, writing is an art. Being able to speak is an art. To be able to come up with theories and be able to conduct research can be considered an art.
Though might not require formal education?
Absolutely, that would require formal education.
Okay. Yeah. So I want to come to the audience, if we can just get the mic there.
For every year of education that you have, it pays dividends in the long run. However, this year that we're seeing a lot of graduates in their field are not finding the job, or not finding their career paths, because the market just isn't there anymore. So what would you say to someone who, say, let's say, I have done 4 years in biology or sciences. Now I can't find a research position if I want to go into my research sciences. What should I do at that point that I can't find the job that I want?
So I want to come to you because, we're discussing how students come out of university, they got their formal education, and have a difficult time sometimes locating the ideal job. Although as a doctor, I know that sometimes there's a waiting list. They can't wait till you finish school. So, does one think about that at least I'm in a safe career, or does that thought go, like, is that part of the decision making, that's why I want to have this career where I have that shelter?
Well, certain jobs, certain fields will give you more sense of job security, and obviously medicine is one of those. It's not as influenced by the economy, and that's definitely something you think about when you're going out and choosing a career. But at the same time, I think it's really important that you're fulfilling all of your own ambitions and making sure that that's exactly what you want to do. And if this wasn't exactly what I wanted to do, then I would have no problem picking another field. And just to get back to some of the points that we were talking about earlier, where people run into roadblocks and hurdles as to, I can't find a job, or I can't find a research position. That's the point where, first off, you pray. And secondly, you have to get your deepest ambitions and try to go for it. And I know personally, residents that are in their 40s and their 50s, and they've done other careers and they weren't satisfied with them, and they went back in, completed entire residencies 5 years, 5 years plus, to just to satisfy their goals, despite being in the medical field. So as mentioned earlier, I think you have to be very happy with what you're doing.
Okay. And go ahead, I want to come to the audience.
I just wanted to bring a point about practicality. A lot of people, when they're making career choices, they're not practical about the job prospects. It's great that you like being an artist, right? But then you equally like science. So considering the job market, I would be more inclined to go for science and have that as a passion or as a hobby, as my fellow audience member mentioned before. So I feel like there's a lack of guidance. And for that reason, I want to direct a question to the doctor in the panel. A lot of people here in the audience, they want to pursue medicine, but I feel like they don't know what they're getting into. So if you could just shed some light on what's the lifestyle like and what are the decisions that you're making when you're going for medicine, so people have a clear vision of what they're getting into.
And especially because, from what I understand, it's a really long journey as well.
It's definitely a long journey. I like to think of it as, a lot of investment, but a lot of reward at the end. And I think that's how most people going into the medical field like to think about it. You can't start counting the years out of high school. It's so variable. Some people will do, finish everything in, 8-10 years. Other people will be out for much longer. So you really have to remember that it's quite a variable field when it comes to years of education that you're going to put in. Your question about the lifestyle is also related as well, because depending on what kind of field you get into, it can be your lifestyle is going to be very varied. Surgical residencies, for example, you're going to put in 100-hour weeks in the hospital. You're going to be starting at 8 a.m., working the whole day, and then staying in the hospital the entire day the next day, and then going home in the evening. And sometimes you won't sleep. You'll survive on chocolate bars, that type of thing. You're not allowed to leave the operating room, that type of thing. However, on the other side, there's more lifestyle-friendly specialties as well. Where there's very minimal call, there's still a lot of responsibility, but there's also more flexibility as to how many patients you see. So there's physicians out there that even work part-time. There's many physicians that take certain time off, take their kids to kids to school in the morning and in the evening, and they can work 30 hours a week and be happy. So it really comes down to what you want your lifestyle to be like.
That's really interesting, and I mean, surprisingly for me, I'm really glad to learn that doctors eat junk food too. So that's
all the time.
Okay, so I want to come back to the audience, and I kind of really want to understand, when you're making that choice, what are some of the factors you keep in mind? Do you look at economy? Do you think about what you love and what you want to do? And if I can hear some of the feedback for some of the students and some of the audience member who are looking to take that leap, what are some of the deciding factors? Go ahead.
Some of the main deciding factors are, one, you have to be honest with yourself. You have to look at your grades. If you want to go into medicine, you know you need very high marks. And if you're not getting them and you don't have the aptitude for it, so sometimes you have to be realistic with yourself. People, sometimes they don't have a talent for something, or something just doesn't click with them. So for me, one, it was a passion. I loved science and I loved the medicine field. And then secondly, I had to assess my grades. And then if they were on the lower end, I was like, I have to work a little bit harder. So before grade 12, if my grades aren't this or this, then I know I can't do this. So I had to bring my grades up. I had to put that work in. And that was the main thing. It wasn't really the job market or anything, because it is a safe field. So it's about passion and being honest with yourself, whether you can really do it.
If we can get the mic back there, what are some of the deciding factors as you're thinking about a career? Do you look at the economy and assess from there, or do you go after what you want to do? What do you base your decisions on? Parents, economy, society, yourself?
I think speaking to that, there are so many variables that we've discussed, and I think one of the audience members said before that there's not much guidance. And I'd have to disagree with that, because I think, especially after the latest hit to the economy, I think that especially here in Canada, schools have realized that there has to be more education regarding making career choices. And that's why I remember when I was in high school, we had classes dedicated to making career choices, where we took everything into consideration, what our own interests are, what the economy is looking like, what the job security is like. And all of this put together, you kind of come up with three or four different options, really narrow it down so you know that where you want to go, what you want to do. And if one thing doesn't work out, you have a fallback plan where you can go to another career. So I think, especially here in Canada, the education system has changed according to the economy and, everything that's going on in the world. It's okay. Changed so that it's easier to make career choices for students.
Interesting. If you can get the mic over, what did you base your decision on?
I based my decisions on the different market trends that are going on.
Keep a close eye on the economy?
Yeah, I keep a close eye on the economy. And so that's why I started doing a business and operations supply chain management. I realized that this is a pretty niche market. There is a demand for it. Every company needs to learn how to be lean and utilize all their resources and make the maximum profits. So it was something I liked. I like playing with money, so this is something that I got into.
Okay. So what was the deciding factor for you?
So I'm pursuing medicine, and the deciding factor for me was, honestly, it's a stable career. When it came down to it, it was between that or becoming a pilot, which was my other passion. But looking at the job market and the practicality.
Is it safe to assume pilot was your first passion?
Pilot was my first passion.
But you went for the security?
I went for the security, yeah.
Literally, like the safer career?
Literally the safer career there. And as my fellow audience member brought up the point about guidance, I feel like the Canadian education system has given guidance, but in the wrong direction. So when I was in high school, I was always put down. They were always like, getting into medicine is so difficult, it's so competitive. Go for trades. Like, the biggest thing was to finish high school and get into the job market. And that for me was like, when I went into university and I saw how many options there are out there, I was like, what were our guidance counselors thinking? So there might be guidance, but it's the wrong kind of guidance. The guidance says like, oh, you can go out and you might have the skill set to start up a business, but nobody knows at that point what they're getting into. And I feel like it's a decision that has to be made with a calm head, and you have to think about your options, think about the potential job market, and also, you know, factor in the Jamaat thing. Like for myself, I'm in Waqf-e-Nau, so that played a huge role in my decision as well.
Okay, if we can get Hazur in his recent visit to Canada also, you know, addressed this to the AMHSA students. And he said that when I presented the statistics to him, that upwards of 40% of Canadian AMHSA students were in business studies. So he said that don't think too much of making money. It was Hazur's guidance towards us, but serve mankind as well. And he, you know, reminded us of this hadith as well. Coming to your question about changing career paths or going back to school later in, you know, one's career, you know, I am a strong adherent to education. You know, it is incumbent upon us to be educated, to seek knowledge. And the more you have, the more confident you feel, the more, you know, you can say that you're better off in life as well. You are faced with lots of challenges. You can, you know, take care of those challenges. Personally, going back to law was this reason for me.
Okay. But people want to come back to you as you hear this feedback. I want to hear your raw feedback. What, you know, when you hear a lot of this, is this something you usually hear? Do people come up to you and tell you, I'm just looking to make money, or I currently have a job and I really hate it, and I want something that I enjoy doing? What are some of the most frequently asked questions?
Sure. So the first feedback is, I mean, this is a very informed audience, I must say. I mean, in terms of, there's a lot of different opinions, and everyone's very well researched in terms of at very early stages that, you know, what are they good at, what are their attributes, what are their strengths, what are their weaknesses, you know, and also factoring personal and family sort of motivation. So I think that's great that they're early and they're thinking about it early, they're educating themselves early. Sorry, the question was...
The question is, you know, was any of this surprised? Do you get this all the time? And what are some of the questions you get asked directly?
So no, not a surprise in terms of, you know, in terms of the questions or the thinking around the questions. I think that we're in a time right now where there's a lot of great degree of uncertainty, as you prefaced the program with. And a lot of people are concerned about their future, their economic future, their professional future, the future of their families. So these questions are very common. Some of the questions that I get commonly asked is, you know, obviously, where is it that I can find a job, period? Where can I make the most, what profession is potentially the most lucrative or potentially most financially viable? So that's very common. The other piece, I think it was mentioned earlier, was that a lot of young professionals or graduates come out of school and they don't necessarily where they want to be career-wise, or they're not finding work, and that leaves them often disillusioned or maybe unhappy about where they are. And so that's often a lot of, I get a lot of questions get reached out for help to myself about how I can help them with their particular career or whatever they're struggling with at the time.
As a doctor, there must be those long days that you were just talking about earlier. Does that thought ever cross your mind that, you know, maybe a different career path? Like, once you're a professional in a field, I'm just trying to gauge how frequently does that thought cross your mind? If all three can shed some light, like, do you actually ever look back and go, oh, I want to do something different? So I just, you know, I'll start with you.
Yeah. So yeah, there's those long nights on call, and everyone going through the medical training program will admit to those. And, you know, they ask themselves, you know, why are you doing this? But again, like I mentioned earlier, it's about looking at the end result. And you know, as long as you have that focus, that's fine. You know, if it's getting to a point where, you know, you feel like you can't do it, and I've seen that happen to other professionals, then there are obvious other pursuits you can go to. So to answer your question, yes, it has happened to people that I know even. But the majority of people, and you know, even like 99% of people that start med school will end up finishing and going on to residency, and it's just about having that goal. And I think one other thing, just to feedback on what the audience was saying earlier, was You know, I think one of the common problems and in the high school demographic is thinking that you have to, you know, take this fork in the road and choose one of two options. And, you know, education is a lifelong process and it's based on continuous feedback. So whenever, you know, you have those episodes where you're taken back a little bit, you can see, you know, what can I do different? How can I take this to make myself better? And doing that and trying to stay positive is how you can take the next steps forward instead of, you know, taking a million steps back.
Sure. Most of we hear a lot of, you know, personal breakdowns, people having midlife crises, and sometimes it's leading based on a career. People really dread their job. You know, you're a professional. Have you ever felt anything like that? Do you hear that?
Well, when you were asking a question, I was hoping that you weren't directing it to me, but it seems that you are. It is important to highlight certain things. I think it has been said from the audience earlier that I don't want to defend the education system of Canada, but I feel that I'm obliged to, knowing more about it, having done research, to convey to my fellow Canadian Hodam students. It is the responsibility, really, as the director for AMHSA to know about a little bit about education system. So earlier, a panel member, an audience member said that they felt that Canadian education system was not doing justice to steering people into the right field, or, you know, it was also said, you know, it was a fork, you know, towards a certain field. We have certain programs in place, such as Take Your Kids to Work Day.
It's a pretty popular program, especially in high schools.
Very popular. Now, we also have the, you know, Guidance Counselor Office. Also, now it's mandatory for to attain a high school diploma, you must complete volunteer experience and you must attend a certain place 40 hours. So what they're doing is they realize at a certain level, a certain age in life, you haven't been exposed to different things in the world, career. So this brings me to the point that why would someone change a career path? In my particular case, and giving a broader example, it doesn't mean certainly you're changing a career path. A lot of things are complementary to your career. So if you have a economics degree, you might want to specialize in financial, you know, analysis. So yes, you do go to become a CFA, and you may actually pursue that further, and you become a lawyer, and you can do a lot more with that economics background and apply that in a legal industry.
Very interesting. That being said, with this dialogue happening, we are going to take a quick break and we'll be right back to you.
Allahumma salli ala
The Review of Religions is one of the longest-running religious magazines. In print since 1902, it continues to play an important role in presenting the noble teachings of Islam, reflecting its rational, harmonious, and inspiring nature. It features articles and viewpoints on different religions, making religion and religious philosophy accessible to a wider readership. The Review of Religions was founded by Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him, who claimed on the basis of divine revelation that he was the promised Messiah and Mahdi, whose advent had been foretold by the Holy Prophet of Islam, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, and by the scriptures of other faiths. The annual subscription of this unique and enlightening magazine is just £15 per year, or $30. To receive your copy of The Review of Religions, visit our website at www.reviewofreligions.org, where you can browse past issues and subscribe online, or contact us by email to info@reviewofreligions.org. The Review of Religions, a unique magazine of religious thought.
And welcome back. Right before the break, we were discussing what are some of the initial steps that youth take nowadays, whether it's based on economy, society pressure, family, something they're good at, to be able to take that leap into career. And then, Saab, if I can come to you, as a doctor, did you, what were some of your inspirations? Was it family? Was it personal? You know, of course, we just heard that, you know, being a doctor, it does, for the most part, seem very recession-proof.
Yeah. So, I mean, my story is, my father is a physician as well, but I was never pressured into pursuing the same career at any point. But at the same time, I had a lot of exposure to, you know, hospitals and clinics and that type of thing. I originally, in high school, decided that I wanted to be a dentist, and you know, it seemed like a, you know, a fun job, and the lifestyle was great, and that's what I wanted to do. As I went through undergrad, though, I found myself getting more and more interested in the sciences, and I ended up doing a degree in pharmacology, which is the study of drugs and how they work in people. And I really liked the science of it, and I said, you know, dentistry I'm not going to be happy with, because I won't be able to do what I like. So that's why I chose medicine. Now, being in the program now, our audience member mentioned, you get to have that satisfaction from seeing patients, get to develop those compassionate relationships, and get to serve in humanitarian purposes as well. So that's what drives me now.
But Tiba, I want to come to you, and you know, one thing that we often hear is somebody makes a career move because it was a better financial fit. I'm sure as a headhunter, there's firms that decide that they want somebody and they're willing to pay the top dollars, and you see some of the people, you know, give up a job that they're already fairly satisfied with. Mm-hmm. What is it usually? Is it the money that makes them make that decision? Because a lot of companies, when they really want somebody, you hear all these stories. Mm-hmm. Most recently, Yahoo acquired one of the Google founders, well, actually somebody that played a really pivotal role with that organization, who's now the CEO at Yahoo. What type of a role recruiters play? And is that happening a lot now, where people are making a career shift simply because it was a better financial decision?
I think money definitely plays a part in it. I think I would be lying if not saying that money's not a part of the equation. But for instance, the example you gave of Yahoo, everyone involved in that transaction is very, very wealthy. Many of them are billionaires who were involved in that transaction. And I think that at that point, it's really about fit. And studies have shown over and over again that you could give people more money. You can throw more money at people, offer salary raises, but if they're not content with what they're doing, or if they're not fully satisfied, that money increase or that potential increase in salary is a temporary sort of high or temporary solution to entice the person to take a job or get into that career. So absolutely, there's careers that attract. People are attracted to certain careers that are potentially very lucrative. So myself personally, I was always interested to become a stockbroker. I saw a couple movies and I thought, okay, I got a very glamorized version of being on Wall Street or Bay Street, and thought this is what this would be. But when you look, you dig a little bit deeper into the profession and you realize the burnout, the stress, the what you're doing in terms of your contribution to society. Yes, you can make a ton of money, but it's not necessarily something that is long-standing. And there's other, you know, you're giving up a lot. So to answer your question, no, it's not always money. I think longer term, it's always fit and how you feel about the role and the job that you're doing.
Okay, and one question that I have just generally, and if I can get everybody's feedback on, is there are certain careers where you don't just come out of school and immediately get that job. For instance, you know, different broadcasters, you really have to go through a cycle. I want to really talk about some of those careers, though. They're, you know, for example, a prime minister of a country, you don't go to university for that. There is no degree program, and that's it. You come out and they'll hire you as a prime minister, or though there's a voting system, and you know, careers that involve climbing that ladder. Mm. If I can start with yourself.
There are certain events in one's life that you end up in certain place that you don't design or you can't plan to be in. So a lot of things are, you know, incidental. But coming back to the education system, that once you start a degree, you choose a career for yourself, you may change it, like we were suggesting earlier, that on average people do change it. But to excel into some program, you must have a passion for it. Creating a life for yourself where you have really shown to excel like a president of a country, you know, you just don't by chance become that person. There are some characteristics that one needs for that.
So is it that acquired character that really helps you elevate? Or, because I mean, I understand that education can only get you so far, but what else is there?
Definitely have to have that drive, and I can comment from a medical perspective. You talked about climbing the ladder, but essentially for most of our lives we're climbing the ladder, and it really never ends, and you don't know what the end result is, but you want to keep going. So even the whole medical system in a hospital is based on almost a hierarchy, where there's a staff physician, he's got his residents, he's got his medical students, and then you've got the whole allied health team. So it's all about graduating through the ranks and trying to become the best that you can be. So again, it's a lot of internal drive, really, that comes down to it. And if you don't have that, then it's difficult to progress.
Sure, Matib, if you could shed some light, and I'm sure you get this all the time, where sometimes people will take a lower paying salary to work for a well-branded company. You know, there seems to be less of a commitment in terms of careers, where, you know, if you go back 50, 60 years, you would hear a story, somebody spent 50 years working for this one company, right. and they get into the cycle of it, and they really proudly tell, where that can almost be looked at as a negative thing now, if your resume only has one employer that you've ever worked for. Right. So when you're looking at these resumes, how much of a role does that play?
Well, you know, I think, you know, the first point you mentioned about someone being, you know, our parents' generation, where you pick the profession, join the company, and more than likely you maybe change your job once or twice, and more than likely you retired there. Those days are pretty much gone, where people not only change positions often, but in certain cases, I think, as I earlier mentioned, that people even change professions maybe two or three or four times in their lifetime. And, you know, as expressed by the audience today, that people have a lot of different interests. You know, they could be science and music, business, and someone mentioned being a pilot. So I think that it's just not the structure anymore, where companies also don't operate that way. The cycles have become shorter, changes become very constant, business and even non-profit or for-profit can change very quickly. So I think the nature of how things operate have changed, and therefore I think we have to change with it, and we've had no choice. So
what are generally the employers looking at nowadays? Because one can argue being with a company for a long time shows a sense of loyalty,
absolutely,
shows a sense of commitment.
Yeah.
But also can be taken in the fact that you've only ever worked for one employer, and we're not really sure how many, because they always look for a well-dimensional person as well.
Yeah, no, and that's a very good point. I mean, absolutely, if we're looking at someone who's been at one company for 10 years, our concern might be that, you know what, this person might not know too much outside of their industry or their employer or their company that they're working for. So, it's a very thin line. I think you need to definitely get to a point where you can stick to different companies and build yourself internally. And I think we're in a time and place now where if an opportunity presents itself and you're looking proactively, definitely you should consider those opportunities. It's just the nature of how things work now. If I can just make an earlier point about the prime minister, there's not necessarily a course that you take or an educational background that to become a policymaker or to run for office. But one thing I will say is that there are certain certain backgrounds that are predisposed to politics and running for prime minister. So if you look at politics, a lot of people come from law or finance. So because they have that legal background, they have that policy making. So if someone's aspiration is to get into politics, it's not something that you can't plan for. You can plan for that, but obviously there's other variables as well, like ambition, you know, your communication skills, how good you are with people. You know, definitely it is possible, but again, requires a definitive plan.
Okay, and I just kind of want to get a general sense from the audience, if we can just kind of get the mic around. Do you plan to be in a career where you can spend many years working for that employer and being in that stability? Do you plan to work for various different companies to try the various different things out there? And just so I can get a general idea of what youth are thinking nowadays, go ahead.
I think a lot of people nowadays, they have a new perspective to the system. A lot of people are fed up with the system. And I think, like one brother already mentioned, that, you know, why not turn around and work to better other people's lives, right? Instead of, you know, trying to climb that ladder. Mm-hmm. And I think, especially being an Ahmadi, being born in the Markaz, Jamaat's instilled this passion for Khidmat-e-Khalq, and I think in a lot of us, and personally in myself.
Okay, interesting. Just get the mic back there. So stay with one employer, try out different options out there.
I would definitely try out different options to broaden my horizon, my knowledge and how the market works. This way I can be a more well-rounded employee. This will help me gain much more market knowledge. It'll help me help better pursue different companies' goals. So I would definitely not want to stick with one job. I would definitely want to jump around.
Okay. Interestingly enough, Matisse, I'm sure you would agree with moving around, or else you wouldn't be in this business that you're in. You know, careers come about from people just moving around, especially as a recruiter, you know, versus companies keep, you know, promoting from within. You know, of course, in the very line of work that you're in, it's simply because more and more people are doing that. So if we can get two different perspectives, maybe from you and yourself as well.
So, you know, the moving around, unfortunately, has been more imposed by companies and corporations, where the people who make decisions in companies are unfortunately very short-sighted now. And the notion of investing in someone and bringing someone on and making turning them out into a lifelong employee just isn't a reality anymore. It may be in certain industries, it may be in certain professions, but in a lot of work that I do, there is a fair amount of movement. And it's accepted as that. It's not viewed as a negative thing, but it's also not viewed negatively if you decide to stay somewhere for a long time. So I think that it really depends on the profession, really depends on the person, and it really depends on you know, the company. Some companies want people to stay there to build internally. They want to promote and hire within, but it really depends on the company. Yeah.
Great. And if we can get your feedback, of course, being in a career that, you know, you usually hear a doctor once, doctor forever.
For the most part, yeah. Again, I think it's such a there's so much variability in that question. Whether you're going to stay with the same company, whether you're going to move around, it totally depends on your experiences and the opportunities you're offered after your successes and your faults as well. So, I mean, there's total benefits to both sides. I think, you know, sometimes you stay in one, for example, I don't know the business world too well, but you stay in one company, sometimes they'll pay for your education, like an MBA, that type of thing, and they'll give you incentives for staying with the same company. Mm-hmm. Whereas sometimes, you kind of run into a roadblock, and you know they know what you're good at, and they won't let you move up those ranks. And sometimes it's better to, you know, maybe make a lateral move into another company and get a little bit of step up and step back the other way. So it's really individualized, and you have to consider, you know, where you're at that point in time.
Sure. And Maltzab, I want to come to you because, you know, more and more, I think that more than just people that are looking to make a career move, I feel that the industry has shifted. The corporations, that term that decorated resume of all the different companies that I worked for, people really like to bring, you know, and more important, there's also a general sense of companies don't necessarily value as much how, you know, how many years you've put in versus what somebody else can bring that they don't already have. So instead of training in-house to get someone to that position, why not bring somebody in who might be at a competitor and can clearly help you get that competitive advantage?
Okay, so to me, it makes sense to for the companies to recruit from competitors, but as long as the loyalties are there. And also, one has to realize that the employers may be thinking psychologically as well. You know, it's a popular, well-known fact that the big corporations, they look into the psychology of the company, which they call organizational behavior. Where is the company headed? Sometimes, if you're a long-term employee, you're not at your maximum output anymore. The new innovation, you may not be contributing to. So you may have become stagnant sitting at your position. Whereas if you are holding to your desk, you know, and the employer switches you around, takes you out of your comfort zone, forces you to start thinking, they may be actually, you know, giving themselves a favor by doing that.
Okay. And Najm Sahab, if I can start with you, you're a doctor, you said your father's a doctor. Did you ever feel that, you know, generally there was that expectation of you?
I think the expectation was not to be a doctor at any point, and it's nice because I was very comfortable growing up, but there was definitely an expectation to become a professional. And I guess that was carried on because of what he did and what some of his family members did as well. But I think overall, I had that in mind growing up. You know, I had an open mind. Law didn't appeal to me as much. Engineering I thought about as well, but I ended up in the health field and finally decided to figure something out. But I think overall, having a little bit of guidance or a little bit of push from your parents can help.
Okay. Steve, if you can add to that.
You know, I think that, you know, we come from cultures and communities where the, you know, I think someone mentioned a point earlier that, you know, a lot of our parents struggled to come to this country. And, you know, they maybe, you know, worked in jobs that, you know, that weren't in their professions. Or they struggled to ensure that, you know, us, the next generation, can sort of be in those aspirational careers. So I think that's something to consider. That, you know, and I know that, you know, being obviously a doctor, lawyer, I think it's a fairly aspirational career within our community. But I think that's something to keep in mind that, you know, we are in the country where anything is possible, in my opinion. I mean, despite our challenges, despite what we're facing, I think that if anything is possible, it's in this country. If not here, then where at this point? So I think that the platform is there. And I think that sometimes parents, they're well-intentioned. And maybe you have to understand they come from a time where, you know, there were only maybe a couple options. A lot of things have changed in the last 10, 15 years. So, you know, they looked at, you know, a doctor, a lawyer, or engineer. So I think, you know, whatever you pursue is fine. But I think that, you know, keep that in mind that whatever you pursue, it's aspirational and you know, progresses us as a community and yourself and your family to the next level.
Okay. In wrapping things up, Latif, if I can ask you from a recruiter's perspective, when you go through thousands of resumes on a monthly basis, from entry-level positions to senior executive-level positions, for the viewers watching at home, what would be not just advice, but, you know, starting points that you would recommend to the viewers at home?
Well, I would say that, you know, we've talked about a lot of issues today. We talked about education. We talked about you know, making career choices. And I think that, you know, the biggest thing I would say is that no matter what you decide or whatever path you decide to choose, the biggest thing you can control is yourself and your effort. So I think whatever you do pursue, the biggest outcome will be from what you put into it. It is what you put into it. So if you think a fancy degree or certain connections will get you to where you want to be, that might only get you so far, but the rest of it really relies on the person and the individual themselves and their individual effort and persistence. I think that trumps everything. Yes, you should be educated. Yes, you should be aware and seek knowledge, but I think at the end of the day, being persistent and being persistent about your goals and being targeted is what will get success.
Sure. Najm, as a doctor, what advice would you give to our viewers at home?
Yeah, so echoing that a little bit, so number one thing is excel at whatever you do and go give your wholehearted effort no matter what you're doing. Little task at home, helping someone do something, or whether you're pursuing a postdoctoral fellowship, go all out at it and you'll be rewarded. For the people that are considering, there's been considerable talk about medicine today, but for people that are considering careers in it, especially the high school children, go out and try to do volunteer work. That's really huge. You have to try to get acclimatized to the hospitals, to the healthcare system, develop some of those one-on-one contacts, read newspapers to senior citizens, do that type of thing, and see, and you know, it'll really broaden your thinking a little bit and open up some doors, and it'll help your resume later on too. And then just one of the final things is don't get, you know, stuck in one frame of mind. And we talked considerable amount today about, you know, changing fields and that type of thing. You know, two of my co-residents are actually lawyers, established lawyers, and they're practicing, and they went back and you know, went into medical school, and now they're doing a five-year residency with me. So, you know, really pursue your ambitions, because you're trying to set yourself up down the road.
Okay, and Motsub, of course, having, you know, a few years in, you're the CEO of a realty firm as well. You've taught at universities. You decided to go back to law school. What would be some, one of your, or at least some pointers to the viewers at home?
Okay, the point is that we have to seek guidance from the most blessed institution that we have. Write a letter to Hazur, seek his guidance, and yourself, you should be praying. There's every major step in your life, we are told to do an istikhara. A notion is there that one is feels happiness in himself, herself, while doing that. You have to find yourself as well. You know, you have to be realistic. If it comes to later in your life where you have to change a career or add to your previous career, don't be hesitant. Remember, the life is long, and you have a learning curve throughout your life, and you know, gain experience. In essence, that no career is bad, but we have certain guidelines that we should be pursuing, and that is the top of it is not money at all. We should be looking into helping mankind as well, and making a difference in this life. So once you have made a choice, and you have to you have to strive hard, don't give up, and really excel in your in that career.
Very interesting. So really, in conclusion, and you know, summarizing a lot of what we talked about, especially when choosing a career, educate yourself not just within the career, but searching what the career is all about. We also heard a lot about, you know, what type of a role parents play, what type of role what you see on TV makes. We also had a chance to get some of the feedback of the professionals in their field, and some who made career moves, some who stayed within a stable career. It was really great to hear some of the feedback of people of how they perceive and what they're looking out of a career. We really hope that we were able to answer some of your questions at home. Although it is great to get your feedback, you can always email us, realtalk@mta.tv, or also check out the website, mta.tv/realtalk. Jazakallah.